Hi! Angular 17 was released a couple of hours ago and it brings a lot of new and cool features. One of them, it is a brand new control flow that I'm going to show you in this video. If it is your first time on my channel, my name is Dmytro Mrzecki and I create content mostly about Angular and focus on advanced parts of the framework, and I create single tutorials as well as full video courses that you can check out following the link in the video description. But now let's get started and let's have a look at this brand new built-in control flow in Angular 17. Alright, so let's have a look at this brand new control flow by refactoring a currently existing application that is built using the old approach that relies on ngIf, ngSwitch, ngSwitch case, and ngFor structural directives. The application itself is very straightforward. It has one button, and when you click this button, you will get some random piece of data from the server. It can be a list of users, it can be a list of posts, or a list of some other data. And our goal is to recognize which data type we received from the server, and depending on that, we have to render either user list or post list, or show the placeholder that we received some unexpected or unknown data type. And you can see if I click it, we received some unknown data type, then I click again, get a user, then at some point I get a post, and this is the whole application. And this input exists for a reason, because I can perform some quick search and find or not find some certain element in the list. All right, so let's get started with refactoring and applying this new control flow. So since Angular 17, you can use the following syntax: if data exists, do whatever you need. For example, we render this part. If not, this is the else block. There we render things that should appear if there is no data inside. And here you can see that using ngIf directive, we renamed data to the item. And we can do that also with this new syntax. So after the if condition, you use semicolon and then you say as and give any name you like. And this is the same what we had using this ngIf directive. So we can remove this part and make sure that everything remains working perfectly. Love it. And now let's try to refactor this ngSwitch case statement. And this is how it will look like using this new syntax. So you write add, then switch. Inside a switch, you define a condition. In my case, it will be item type, right? And there you define already cases. So in case if the value of the type is string post, we will render app post list component, right? And the ngSwitch case directive, we can safely remove and leave it as it is. And then for the case, if item type is users, then we will render the user list component. And again, we don't need this ngSwitch case directive anymore. And then if the type of the item is not the post and not the users, then we want to show the placeholder that this is the unknown type. And this is a perfect use case for the default case that you can define like that. And here we can render already the placeholder for the unknown type. And as you can see, this new syntax is working just fine. But before I remove this old code, I would like to demonstrate you one very old and significant issue with the ngSwitch case directive that is really annoying, and finally it was fixed by this new ngSwitch syntax. And here I'm talking about type narrowing when you use the ngSwitch directive, because it is really a pain if you have to use the ngSwitch directive with types like discriminated union, for example. Discriminated union, this is the type, let me show you in the data service. This is when you have a multiple objects that have a common key, in my case it's a type, and the value of this type can be different. And depending on the value of the type, the type of the payload also might be different. For example, if the type value is photos, then payload is array of photos. If the type is a string users, then the payload is array of users. And then you use the union operator in order to combine all those types into one discriminated union type. And the idea is that if inside your code you detect that the response has a type posts, then the payload for it has to be resolved to the array of posts. If it is a photos, then the payload will be array of photos and so on. And because the ngSwitch directive cannot narrow types like that, then you had to apply different workarounds. The bad but simple solution is using any, for example, here, or you could use the discriminated union type there, but you would need to adjust it inside the template and use something like any template function that can convert type to any for the template, and in such a way you can make it work. But the new syntax can perfectly narrow the type, and you can see that here payload was resolved to the post because this is the post case, and for the users it was properly resolved to array of a user type, which is really cool and less error prone. And also this new syntax has a proper type checking inside the case statements. For example, inside the type I can have one of these three strings, and if I make a typo and provide an unexpected value here, then I will immediately get the compilation error. But if I do the same mistake in the ngSwitch case directive, I get no feedback and I will see the mistake only when I run my code in the browser. So this was a new, much more powerful switch case syntax. So let's remove the old code and continue with the for loop. And what is here? It's a users list, so let's refactor this component as well. And while I slowly go to this component, please hit the like to this video if you enjoy it and subscribe to my YouTube channel if you didn't do it yet. And now let's jump to this user list component that for rendering the user card uses still this old ngFor structural directive. So how looks the new syntax for the for loop? And it looks like this. You just type for, and here you define the variable, and you don't need the let keyword anymore. You just type the user or whatever name you want to give to this variable, and then you say of filtered. In my case, filtered, it is a computed signal that tracks the signal query. This is the string we enter here. And if it changes, then we filter users depending on their name. Okay, so this is how it works. And there inside of the for block, we can already define the template we want to repeat. In my case, this is this part, and remove this ngFor directive because we don't need it anymore. But as you can see, it is not enough because we have an error that says that the for loop must have a track expression. This track, it is equivalent to track by in ngFor. This function has to return some unique key that will be used by Angular in order to prevent unnecessary component recreation. And in such a way, it will have a positive impact on your application. And because it was always a good practice to use this track by function in new syntax, it became required. And here you can apply it by using the track keyword, and here you have two options. You can define immediately the key that you want to track. In my case, it could be user ID. Or if you have some complex logic, or because of migration reasons, you want to reuse the track by function, you can reuse it right here and explicitly provide values that this function is needed. For example, this function requires index and item itself. The index you can get using this dollar sign index variable, and the user item you can provide by just taking this and place it as a second argument for this function. And this is enough in order to make it work. And of course, like before, you can also get a reference to the context variables like index, and you can define them after the semicolon like this one, but the name is changed to the dollar sign. Or with this new syntax, you can use those variables directly inside a template. It is also possible. So now I can remove this old template. I can also go and remove the track by function, because now I can use this simplified syntax and provide the track idea just like that. And if I save everything, you can see that things remain working as before. Besides that, this new syntax also brings some significant performance improvements, especially when it comes to for block. This is because this is a building block that can interact with Angular internal data structures on a low level, and it helps to remove some significant amount of the overhead and make the algorithm more lightweight, smarter, and eventually it consumes less memory. But wait a second, do not go. Wait a second, I'm going to show you another really cool feature that has this for block. And the thing is that quite often we want to show some message to the user when there is nothing to iterate through. For example, if I try to find the user that doesn't exist in the list, then I want to show this nice banner that says that the user was not found. To achieve this functionality, one of the solutions would be something like wrapping our for loop with some additional ng container, then apply the ngIf directive and check if the length of the array we are going to iterate is more than zero, then we iterate through. Otherwise, we show some template like here. But this new for syntax has an additional block called empty that allows you to handle exactly this case. So inside the empty block, you just place the template that has to be visible when there is nothing to iterate, and that's it. Then you can remove all these parts, you can remove this ng container wrapper, and this is it. Now, if you save the change, you can make sure that things remain working as before. And what you can also do is to completely remove this imports array, because you don't need ngFor and ngIf directives, and remove them from imports right there above. And the same we can do for our app component. And from the imports array, I can remove this group of directives and leave only components that I'm using there. And of course, I can remove this imports line here above too, which is a nice bonus. All right, guys, it was everything I wanted to mention regarding this brand new control flow and really cool thing. I really love it. I have been playing with this new syntax maybe last couple of weeks or even more, and I really enjoy that. And when I have to get back to this old syntax based on the structural directives, I feel like, why didn't we get this new syntax earlier? But I would like to hear your opinion. Did you like this new control flow? Did you like the syntax? Please let me know in the comments under this video. It will be very interesting discussion. And also share this video with your colleagues and friends if you find this video useful, and don't forget to check out my advanced Angular video courses. And by the way, the new video course is coming. It will be released very, very soon. Otherwise, I wish you a productive week ahead, guys. Stay safe and see you in the next video.